Good morning. Welcome to Higher Hope Church. You stand in worship with us.
Welcome to Higher Hope this morning. We're glad that you're here. This is our 15-year celebration. We're started last week and kind of celebrating until next month. And actually, this Sunday right now is the actual weekend that we started 15 years ago. And so first of all, I want to welcome you here to the celebration and what God has in store for us in this series called Cultivating the Kingdom. Just want to highlight a couple things that we talk about every weekend. One is the connection cards in front of you. They're there to communicate. We pray over those. If you have information that you need on something, a small group, if you want to sign up for something, Any way you need to communicate with us, you can use right on those. There should be a pen in there as well. There are offering baskets in both sides of on each set of doors, and also a connection card basket. You can put the connection cards in either of those. It's just a great way to communicate. We also have the Higher Hope app, which you can use to communicate as well. There's ways to ask for prayer requests, sign up for the church email, and those things as you want that. And so we want you to get involved that way. Also, during the service, anytime you are worshiping or during the message and God's just laying on something in your heart to pray about, we want to be a house of prayer. We want to be a place where people are seeking God and using the time, the hour to really get before him and be at his feet. And so you can do that, obviously, in your seats. But we also have a cross in the back that if you just need a place to get away, you and Jesus, and just you're wrestling with something or you're interceding for somebody, feel free to go to the cross. You can take someone with you and pray there, or you can pray by yourself. But we want to be offering that as we just worship together. Also, just offering-wise, giving-wise, this is the last week that we will be collecting funds for Ecuador. Again, Ecuador is the mission. Contigo is the name of it. Oswaldo is the leader. And we're collecting funds for diapers, medical supplies, and Christmas shoes. And so if you want to get involved in that, one of our core values is generosity as a church. And so we try to find needs and meet needs in the community and overseas. And so that's one way we're meeting needs this month is through that missions offering. We'll give you an update next week on how much was given, but we're excited to be able to partner with a ministry like that who's serving their city by providing needs of orphans and mothers and just spiritual, physical, emotional needs that way. One of the things we want to do during the series is kind of tell stories. You know, God is a story writer. He's a beautiful, amazing story writer. And obviously we read the stories of Scripture and we can be amazed by that. But God is writing individual stories as well. And obviously we can't tell the full version. We're not getting the epic 12 book side of it. We're getting the Reader's Digest newspaper article version of it. But I wanted you to hear a few things that God is doing over the last season of Higher Hope and also in people's lives. And so I'm going to ask Justin to come up, and can I borrow the mic? And I just have a few questions for him, just so you get to know Justin. He's one of our elders, and also so you can see the journey that God has him on and some things we can celebrate that way. So 15 years ago, I don't even know if I talked to you. I don't think I actually did. I don't know how you actually ended up saying yes to coming to a church plant.
Actually, you did.
Okay. It was so memorable for me.
It was actually at my in-laws' house. And at the time, I was a manager at Home Depot. I worked every Sunday morning, and you and Gina were talking about this church you're going to start. You needed, I think it was like 15 families, 20 families, something like that. I knew statistically that, you know, most churches like this fail. We walked out of there, and Stacy's like, I want to do it. And I was like, I don't really care. It's not really going to impact me. So, yeah, let's go ahead and do it. So yeah. It really wasn't me. It was really Stacy and my mother-in-law, especially my father-in-law, was really, Sam was on board with it. So that is actually how we got started coming to Higher Hope.
All right, so you look at the 15 years, and obviously there's a lot of twists and turns in your life. You've probably moved a lot, you know, and, you know, there's other things that have happened. But church-wise, how have you changed, and how has Higher Hope been part of that journey for you?
Like a really big turning point for me was probably 3, maybe 4 years in. There was a couple of messages. There were some challenges about reading the Bible. And at the time, I'm working 40, 50 hours a week, actually probably 50, 60 hours at Home Depot, going to school full time, working on my master's degree. And I'm like, I don't have the time. Like, reading the Bible is a good thing. I know the stories. I've never read the Bible. And you challenge just 10 minutes. So every day after work, I'd go to the library and I'd do my schoolwork. So I made a deal with God. I said, I'll give you 10 minutes. But if my grades drop, you're gone I'm going back to my grades. So not only did he keep the grades up, but 10 minutes became 15 minutes, became 20 minutes. I was still home when I needed to be, and it was just such an eye-opening experience. And I would really, you know, it was such a pivotal moment in terms of, I was raised Catholic, which was you kind of showed up on Sundays, you did the bazaars, you did the spaghetti dinner, stuff like that, and then you left. And in terms of reading the Bible, it really created, like, we're on a mission. We're called to do things, to go out into the world, to share, to bring people to faith. And that was really kind of the turning point for me. And the fact that Higher Hope was willing to invest and push that hey, read, you got to read, you got to read, is really what drove me to read the Bible, make a deal with God, and then he showed me up.
Well, that's good, because I'm talking about that today, too, so that's a good segue there. Yeah, we didn't talk about that beforehand. What are you excited about at Higher Hope as you're looking? So we look back, and then obviously there's a lot of other things that happened along the way, you know, but as you're looking ahead of what God, you see God doing here, what are you excited about?
I'm excited because Higher Hope, I think Ralph Moore talks about this, that there are really two types of churches. There's lake churches that just kind of collect resources, they hold them in, those are your bigger mega churches. And then there are river churches where things just kind of pass through. And I'm so excited about the programs that we've worked on, that we're developing, the AIM classes, these programs that really help people learn their callings. And we're able to send people out, like Jeremy with the Transformation Center. There's been countless mission trips that have gone on. I just see so much in our future in terms of Higher Hope not being this just collection, but being a launch pad for so many people and for so many ministries, not only locally, but internationally as well.
All right. Yeah, I'm excited about that as well. So this is Justin. Again, he's one of our elders. And so thank you for sharing piece of your story. I know there's a lot more there. But let's pray as we worship together. Heavenly Father, just thank you for how you work. Thank you for even the little challenges of reading your word and how powerful your word is, how it transforms, changes, that your voice is heard through it. And thank you for what you have done and Justin and Stacy and the kids' lives, and pray even more as they move forward with their calling, and pray also over our celebration here that you just show up. May there be more stories and more stories of pivotal moments of change in people's lives. And so, God, this is what we're about here at the church, is seeing lives changed, and we want to celebrate that, and we also seek you to move more and more in that direction and people's lives change. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand with us?
I'm
thankful that you are so worthy of our praise, that you are mighty in power, strong to save. Lord, we thank you so much for the divine power that you have and the way that you fill our souls. And I pray that we always praise your name, that everything that we see, that everything we do, Lord, just reminds us that you are with us and that you are for us, and that our soul thirsts for you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Go ahead and have a seat. We are in this Cultivating the Kingdom. And I want to kind of do a rewind because I need to have you have that picture of last week of what we're talking about. In Genesis chapter 2, God creates Adam and he places him. He moves him from wherever he is into the garden that was created for him in this perfect environment to cultivate it and guard it. That we were called to work. We were called to design. I like to say this, we are, as followers of Jesus Christ, world makers. We are culture makers. You know, we don't have to be afraid of culture. We have to see in our eyes that God has given us the power and the ability to cultivate culture in our families, in our work environment sometimes, in our communities, wherever it is, your mission is that we are called to cultivate, that we are bringing the kingdom wherever God has placed us. We are called to bring what the kingdom of God was supposed to look like into our world. And so this is an old diagram, and I want to update it sometime. Do we have that from here to there diagram? All right, simple, right? This is a really kind of simple principle that we've talked about often. We are wherever we are. It doesn't matter where here is, spiritually, traveling-wise, you need to know where there is, right? Where are we going? Where is the finish line? What are we trying to get to? And we are traveling. Discipleship is the line in between. It's the journey from here to there. If God has designed us for fullness, if God has designed us for flourishing, if God has designed us for joy and peace, and then the love, hope, along the way, if God is really like, that's what he's designed us to be, that's the there, and we are wherever we are, how do we get there? All right, we've talked about this idea of moving from here to there, and I want you to, I found this video, I watched this video this last week, and this is an addendum to this principle, all right, and I want you to, we'll talk about it after the video, but this is science, so you're getting a science class this morning, all right, but listen, watch this science, it's amazing how it ties into this. Go ahead and show the video.
Scientist by the name of Isa Schaefer. Thank you.
all right, we're moving from here to there, right? We're trying to get to the destination. When you're blindfolded, the tendency is we'll never get there. We think we're going the right direction, but because we have no fixed point that we're focusing on, we have no fixed direction that we're heading toward, we're just kind of walking the way we think we're supposed to be walking. What happens over and over and over, this is a scientific principle, is we end up circling, and actually we end up sometimes further away than where we began. On the journey from here to there, if we don't keep that anchoring point in front of us, we can never get to there. Isn't that a fascinating, if we're called to be cultivators of the kingdom, you know, we're supposed to bring the kingdom, we're supposed to bring his flourishing, bring his, what his kingdom would look like, his reign into our world, and we lose sight of the main focal point, what we do is we just spin. And, all right. Can't you see that happening in people's lives when they're just like walking through life and they think they're trying to get someplace, and do you not see that spinning happening along the way in people's lives? Like they're thinking they're getting someplace, and then they end up, it's the whole three steps forward, two steps back, except it's not three steps forward because you're not making progress a lot of times. It's like three steps forward, four steps back, five steps to the left, eight steps to the right, 12 steps forward, 33 steps, and then you're just kind of wandering through life. And that's not the way God has designed us. And so this series is about here to there, but really about how do we keep a fixed point before? So Proverbs chapter 4. I'm going to start, it's not going to be on the screen, but I'm going to start in verse 20. The center verse is going to be on the screen. So Proverbs, if you don't know what Proverbs is about, it's in the Old Testament. It's the wisdom literature, it's called, you know, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. It's about wisdom. It's about, how we live. How do we make choices? How do we walk wisely in our world? So most think that Solomon is writing most of the Proverbs, so the wisest person on earth, and he writes this in the beginning part, trying to give them a direction from here to there. He's like, all right, if you want to get to there and you don't want to spin, listen to how he words it. See the connection between the video and this. My son, and there's the relational side, pay attention to what I say, turn your ear to my words, do not let them out of your sight, keep them within your heart. For they are life to those who find them and health to one's own whole body. We're going to skip this next verse and go to the next section. Keep your mouth free from perversity. Keep corrupt talk from your lips. Let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you. Give careful thought to your paths of your feet and be steadfast in all your ways. Do not turn to the right or your left. Keep your feet from evil. Do you hear in Solomon, years before this video was made, 1920 was some of this research and these studies, years, decades, centuries before, Solomon basically says the same thing. Fix your eyes straight ahead. Stay the course. Don't turn to the left or the right. Hear what I'm saying. Stay connected to that. Keep your focus. And then the center part of this scripture is verse 23. And it kind of like frames it. And this is where we're sitting this morning, all right? This is what y'all want you to know. As we're looking outward at cultivating the kingdom, we can't start there. We can't cultivate the kingdom out there until we understand this verse right here. It says, above all else, stop. All right, I know, you probably get sick of me slowing down. You know, you're like, get to the whole verse. But I want you to see the detail. He said, listen, I'm going to give you 31 chapters of wisdom. How to deal with your finances. How to deal with friends. How to deal with adversity. How do you have integrity? How do you, the wife or husband that you choose, like wisdom after wisdom after wisdom, verse after verse after verse, like great saying after great saying. And he says, above all the wisdom I can give you, above all else, guard your heart. All right, we're going to stop there for a second. Let's land there. Guard, the idea is like protect. Keep watch. Keep your eyes on. Don't take your eyes off the main thing. This is the main thing. Guard, or maybe the way we're going to say it this morning is cultivate your heart. All right, your soul. What's going on inside of you? Not what everyone sees. This idea of heart or soul is the below the surface. It is what no one understands, no one sees, no one understands what you're thinking right now, no one understands the anguish you may be in or the frustration that you're carrying in or your emotions that you have or your desires for the week, or we don't see that. We see the byproduct of some of those things, but we don't see that. That is your heart. It is the condition of your heart. It says, above all else, cultivate, care for, protect, keep your eye on your heart. Why? For, that's the cause effect. The effect is everything you do flows from it. Or another way you may have heard this is, it is the wellspring of life. Like when you think about life and fullness and what God has designed for us, and the how we speak and how we live and what we do and how we act and our integrity and all those outside things, all the things about cultivating the kingdom, following his calling in our life, what God has designed for us to do, all of it flows out of the spring of our soul. And he's in the center of this. Hey, keep straight, keep going. Don't turn to your left or your right. Above all else, don't be so outward focused that you miss the center point of where the outward focus comes from. You really can't cultivate your family well. You really can't cultivate your marriage well without first cultivating, caring for your soul. You know, in our world, in our lives, we spend a lot of time caring for everything else, caring for our homes, right? We do a lot of work. You know, something breaks, there's a leak in the water faucet. Most of us, well, I should say some of us, we're like, we don't want that leak going on forever. We need to fix it. Some of you may put a bucket under it and deal with it later. But for most of the time, if something is really seriously breaking, you want to get it fixed, you want to get it taken care of, you see it, you notice it, you call, you know, and maybe it's some other version work-wise. You're like, man, I need to solve this problem. If this problem continues, it's going to spiral out of control. Like, you attack it. You like, I'm going to fix this. And we do this in a lot of different ways. We want to grow those things. We want to fix those things. We want to go after those things. When it comes to the soul, we tend to ignore. We are, some of you are living on the edge of burnout, and you're thinking you can just drive right through it. So some of you have anger in your soul, and you're like, that's fine. I have a reason to be angry. And you're like, I'm not going to deal with it. You have deep emotion right now. Like you have like deep sorrow or deep brokenness or deep hurt in your soul. And you're like, no, I'm going to ignore it. I'm going to numb it, because if I can numb it, then we can get through it. And then by the back side of it, I'll be okay, right? Isn't that, we kind of ignore the soul. We pay attention to everything else. We put order to a lot of different things. We'll do the dishes, right? Well, again, some of us. We'll do the laundry. We'll do certain things, but we'll care for things. But when it comes to the above all else thing, we kind of let it spin. And I don't know if there's a more important thing to care for or cultivate or grow in us than our soul, than our heart. And by the way, Jesus says the same thing in the New Testament when he says the good tree brings good fruit out of it, you know, out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. He's like, listen, the most important part of you is your heart, is your soul. And therefore, he actually says this. He's asked in Luke chapter 10, and it's actually in a few of the scriptures in Mark and Matthew as well. He's asked, hey, Jesus, As we're looking at all the laws in the Old Testament, all the maybe even all the Proverbs, you know, all the wisdom, What's the greatest commandment? What's the greatest? We have that verse up there, Luke chapter 10. He answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind. The second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. Do you notice about this verse? You can't measure that. You know, do not murder. That's a yes or no proposition right there. You know, lying, you either lied or you haven't. You know, committed adultery, it's pretty clear on a lot of the commands. Yes or no. You can look from the outside sometimes and say, yes, they obeyed that command. No, they didn't obey that command. This command, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, body, and strength. You can't measure in somebody else. They could, by the way, they could come and look like they're loving God with all their heart, soul, mind, strength. Doesn't mean that they are. And it does. You can't measure. But if you do that, if that becomes the cultivating of your soul, if that's what the work that you do, is that what that's what you're desiring in your heart, it does flow out. It's the most important command because it flows into everything else. Guess what? If you love God with all your heart, soul, body, and strength, you don't have to worry about adultery. You don't have to worry about lying because your soul is already connected to the Father. And you're like, I love him and therefore I want to honor him and I want to glorify him and I want him to be great in my life. And I want to go from here to there. I want to live out his story in my life. And I want him to work. And I just, all of that I am is submitted to him. He's the Lord of my life and I'm committed to this relationship with the Father. Therefore, the Ten Commandments, I automatically keep because I'm loving God with all my heart, soul, mind. That's why it's the center command. Because if you keep that one, all the other ones tend to just fall into place. And so we start looking at the idea of how do we cultivate that love? How do we, I should probably define that a little more because we look at love today as a feeling like I'm in love or I'm out of love. I fell in love with somebody or I'm falling out of love or I can't wait to fall in love. And we think about love as this emotional state and there may be some emotion into this, but our love of God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength is not based on an emotion of love. It's based on the word is agape. It's a commitment. It's a covenant. It's a relational promise. It's a connection. It's a walking with no matter what. And my feelings may go up and down, but I'm tied in. I'm committed. I'm working through this. And the emotions may come and the emotions may go. But it's not based on that. It's based on the commitment or the tie. And guess what agape actually goes even deeper in? It is not based on the other person's behavior or actions. Agape is based on my commitment, which is a very interesting, you know, because there's other words for love in the New Testament. But that's not the word he chooses for his love for us. It's not based on our behavior. It's based on his goodness and his commitment to us. And so he's saying, hey, I want you to deepen your roots into allowing your love for him to grow, your commitment to him to grow, allowing God to have more centerpiece into your life. And so I wanted to share with you, maybe seven, again, there's lots of practices. Okay, so let me explain what I'm talking about. There is the soul of things. And then there is the practices to develop the soul. Our practice means like this. In sports, you practice to make yourself ready for the game, right? And so you may take swings. The swing is not the game. You might not even be hitting a baseball at the time. Practice is getting, it's developing your skills so that when you're in the game, you perform well. So when we talk about practices, they're things that you do, yes, but they're developing your heart or soul for the commitment to Christ. So, well, let me just get into the practices. Practice number one. It's the practice of worship. And then not, Again, I got to define words, because worship not being singing songs, worship being the focus of your heart. All right, let me read this to you. The first fruit of love is the musing of the mind upon God. All right, so when you're in relationship with someone and you're deepening that relationship with them, your mind is thinking about them. Like you are concerned about them. You can play this out when someone, like one of your kids, it's 10:30, they're supposed to be home at 10, and then your mind starts spiraling of where are they? Why didn't they text me yet? They're not responding to my text. They're not calling me. What's happening? Your mind can't think about the refrigerator at that point or what's on television. Your mind is focused on what is happening with your child. Does that mean you guys been there? Some of you been there and understand? Like when you love somebody, when you care for somebody, your mind thinks about that person. That's worship. Right, let me put it this way. You could be in the mall and hear over the loudspeaker, "Hello, we have lost a child. They're this height, this weight, this eye color. If you see this child, please let the guard know." And you'd be like, "Oh, that's too bad. Someone lost their child." And you're walking by and you're like, "All right, I'll look a little bit." But your mind's not constantly there. Now, if it's this way, you're like going to the security guard and be like, "Hey, I don't know why I'm talking to the mic at that point, but hey, I lost my child. I don't know where they are. They wandered off." You can't stop at that point. Like, your mind is on that. You can't get your mind off of that. And so worship is not singing songs. It's not. It is having our mind thinking about and focused on God. And here's some more ways of saying, "He who is in love, his thoughts are ever upon the object. He who loves God is ravished and transported with the contemplation of God." And Psalm 139 says this, "When I awake, I am still with you. God is the treasure. Where the treasure is, there is the heart." And so this idea of worshiping, just contemplating who God is. In fact, a lot of times in the Old Testament, you'll see this idea of the name of God and descriptions of God. And it was all about like God revealing himself, his greatness and his glory to his people. And so there's all these different names and all these different descriptions, and it was all just contemplate who I am. The truth is, all right, let me give you a couple truths. Your picture of God is not accurate. All right, we have a tendency to make God like us. That's all of it. Like what we vote for, what we think about is, and we have to do a better job of contemplating the reality of who God is and align our thoughts with the truth of his revelation of who he really is. And no matter how long we walk with him, he is always greater than what we think. There's always more there to him. There's always more character. There's always more like beauty. There's always more glory. He's greater than our thoughts of who he is. And the more we bring our minds, you go back to the verse, "Love your mind with all your, love the Lord your God with all your mind." It's bringing our thoughts underneath his like thinking about him. Like bringing our attention back to him. Contemplate Christ and his glory. Let me give you a second practice. I call it centering, which is really bringing back to the center of your life what is most important. We tend to drift. That's a fair statement. We tend to move away. All right, we're here this morning. We're contemplating God with our thoughts or whatever. And tomorrow, or when we leave here, we'll be eating lunch, and we've already drifted, right? We've already gone away. Tomorrow is work, and we're always moving into the work. Tuesday is Tuesday. Wednesday is Wednesday. We're constantly moving away. Centering is bringing God back into the center of our hearts, minds, souls consistently. You know, letting the Spirit lead. Letting our thoughts come back to God, bringing prayer without ceasing back into our lives. Centering is bringing back to the most, above all else, guard your hearts and allow God to be Lord of your life, and then center him back. So we need constant reminders of, hey, God is still with you. Do you know that God doesn't leave you, right? He never leaves you nor forsakes you. He's always there. But somehow we constantly forget that he is with us. And every moment he is there. Come back. Center. There's a book called Practicing the Presence of God. I think it was I think it was Henry Nouwen. It's a simple little read about just this idea of everything that this guy did. He would bring the presence of God into it. So that the picture that he had was he would wash dishes, and he would practice the presence of God while he's washing dishes. He'd be like bringing that centering back. Like, hey, God's right here. I'm going to be fully engaged with God right here. I'm going to worship God while I'm doing dishes. And he'd bring that into every area of life. That's centering. Let me give you a third practice. This is one that we struggle with, I think, in our world. Silence and solitude. We live in a busy world with lots of noise, with lots of activity, with like multiple streaming ways to watch television and multiple streaming ways to listen to music and multiple like podcasts that we have on our list. We have Audible that we can listen to. And so we have like noise constantly. And for some reason, God has chosen silence and solitude to be the place where he speaks. Like the more we get away from noise, the more we can hear his voice. The more we can get away from busyness and just sit in his presence, the more our soul is cultivated. Do you know that silence and solitude are good for our soul? Like they bring our heart. I probably should do some study on this, but I think the more noise in our life, the greater our heart rate, right? We're watching the more we can silence things, the more we can bring, the more our heart rate comes down. Like if it's physiological, thank you. Isn't that true spiritual? Right? Isn't it like something that God has put on, as we're cultivating our souls, we're growing our soul, that we need more time away from the noise and more time hearing his voice? And so where do you put that? That's why it's a practice. We're not very good at it. That's why it's a practice. But we need to put that into our practices so that we can cultivate our soul. Let me give you another one. Oh, this is a tough one too. I'm putting the tough ones in for you this morning. It says, love the Lord God with all your mind, all your heart, and all your soul. And part of our soul are our emotions. They're a gift. All of our emotions are a gift. Joy is a gift. We love joy. Peace is a gift. But even frustration and even disappointment, discouragement are a gift from God because they remind us that this is not what we were designed for. Right? It's like pain. Pain tells us that something's not right in our body and therefore we should do something different. Emotions, negative emotions play the same way, but we ignore our emotions. I think emotions are like the dashboard of your car, and when a negative emotion starts flying, we should be paying attention to it, not putting a piece of tape over it, right? We should be like there's a part of us that needs to be able to bring our emotions, be able to decipher why we feel what we feel, and be able to like invite Jesus into the midst of that, rather than just saying, "I'll get over it. It'll be okay. I'll just turn the TV on. I just need a little wine, a little alcohol this tonight to calm me down." We have to take the gift of emotion, and this is a practice because we're not good at this. None of us are good at this. Probably the men in this room are terrible at this. This is what they say about men, by the way. Every emotion is anger, right? And so just so you know, the other side of that, anger is a secondary emotion, all right? So there's always something prime. There's a primary emotion before it that causes anger. But men generally, like anger is there because that's the only way they know how to process emotion is anger, right? That's how we kind of learn. And so we have to like decipher, all right, why? And again, you might sound, this sounds very touchy-feely today, but it's cultivating our soul of understanding, all right, why am I frustrated? Why? Here's one. Why am I yelling at my wife or kid when they didn't even really do anything? Could it be that there's frustration at work and I'm just taking it out on them? Why am I frustrated here? Maybe it has nothing to do with here, but everything to do with here. Or maybe it's because we've drifted from Christ and we have to restore that following him. By the way, just so you know, as we follow Christ, what he's developing in us is faith, a trust in him, a hope, a picture of what the future holds, and love. Love for him and love for others. So that's what, as we spend silence and solitude, as we focus on him, he's developing those emotions in us. And then a byproduct of those are joy and peace, shalom. And that's kind of like the picture of the flourishing of God is joy and peace. And that's what he's working out in us. And in order to walk through that, we have to identify the why. I'm going to give you the next three. I'll try to do it quick. Confession is a practice of the soul. And so, again, I have to define words. Confession takes multiple ways. Most of the time when you hear confession, it's like, I have to stand up in front of the church and tell them what I did wrong. That's not really, or if you're Catholic, you had to go into the Father and kind of share what you did wrong, and then you had to do penance for it. Well, confession is a lot more than any of that. Confession is saying out loud what's already happening in your life. Confession is acknowledging where you are. That's confess. Think about the word. I am saying out loud. It could be in a journal to yourself. That's a confession. It's bringing out into the open what you've been hiding in the light or hiding in the darkness. It could be with a friend. It could be with a group. It could be with your family. Confession is saying, hey, I'm this and I'm struggling with this. It's bringing out what is hidden. And there's power in confession. In fact, James says there's healing that happens when confession takes place. Saying out loud. I mean, think about AA. The basis, one of the bases of AA is, hey, my name is, and I'm a alcoholic. It's acknowledging, confessing the truth. And when you say it, you're like, oh, you're dealing with it. Two other ones, community. Part of the practice of cultivating our soul is doing life together. Someone once wrote, I think it was Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote, sometimes we fall in love with our picture of the church and not the church of itself. You know, we fall in love with the programs, with what we think church should be like, and we've missed the point that church is people, imperfect people, broken people, and we need to fall in love more with each other than with an organization. Fall in love more I care for you and do life with you and do community with you, because community forms. Community works. Community develops. In fact, if you would really listen to your own stories, you'd see that how much people have impacted you, and we need it today. So there's community, and Justin started this, and I'm gonna with this thought, and I'm gonna abiding in God's word. His word is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It's powerful. It transforms us. It is the revelation of God. It keeps our hearts centered. It brings us silence and solitude. It does a work in our emotions. The word of God, when we're inside the Bible, when we're just letting God speak through his word, all this takes place. It's an incredible practice of soul cultivating. And there's a whole lot of other practice I could share with you. At the end of the day, this is what I want to say. We need to do a better job of cultivating our soul. Because out of the overflow of the soul, life happens. Your soul determines so much of how you live out this week. So the question then becomes, how are you cultivating the soul? There's two commitments I'm asking you to make this week, all right? And you can pray about it, you can think about it. Number one is this. We want to set up Wednesday, this coming Wednesday, as a prayer commitment for our church family. Praying over yourself, yes. Praying over your soul, yes. Praying over our community. Praying over our church. Praying over our youth. Praying over our children. We want to say, and we probably want to do this more often, I'm just saying, as one of our practices as a church, we want to be continually getting on our knees, seeking God to work in us as we cultivate ourselves and in our church and with the people around us. We want you to commit to praying, setting aside periodic, like along the way, throughout the day. You can fast as well if you want, praying over the church. Number two is this. You know, I don't expect you to do all seven practices that I mentioned today. But maybe you want to commit to saying, all right, I'm going to pick one or two. I'm going to do it for the next 40 days is always a good number in Scripture, so I would like to use that as a way of, because usually the first week you're like, this isn't working. Well, most things don't work in the first week. You have to let it play out. You have to let it deepen. You have to let it take root. And so do it over and over and over again. That's why we do it 40 days. So committing to saying, all right, this is my practice. I'm going to do one of those seven. I'm going to do two of those seven. And then you're going to write it down. You're going to share it with somebody and say, all right, hold me accountable. Let's pray together as the worship team comes up, as we just worship together. Heavenly Father, as we look at your word and what it says, I pray that we won't spin, we won't walk in circles, our eyes will be fixed on the finish line of what you called us to, that we'll be able to center our thoughts on you, that we'll be able to worship you, not just in song, but in just seeing you as the God of Scripture and the God who works and the God who is involved in our lives, that we can just put ourselves, help us to cultivate our souls before you. Help us to work and walk in health. So God, as we worship together with this last song, may you take it, may you keep helping us process this idea of cultivating our soul. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand with us?
Thank you.
I'm going to invite a couple people up. Kip, you want to come up here? And Luann. So Luann, I'm going to start over in this direction, emailed me maybe a week and a half ago about something that God had put on her heart, and she wrote some things about really prayer and putting prayer at the center of the church. And so it was because Luann emailed me, that's why we're doing the Wednesday prayer thing. We want to make it more consistent. So I thought I'd have her share some things that God has laid on her heart about prayer and Wednesday and how this can look.
Hi, my name is Luann Saxton, and I'm a child of God. Hallelujah! That's right. A couple weeks ago, I was sitting in church, and Mike was talking about praying at the cross. And this little voice comes into my head and said, tell him. Tell him. Okay. You know, I'm not one to act. You know, I hear these voices. Okay, not strange voices, not mental voices. But I hear this voice, and I don't often act on it. And I said, I have to act on it. So I talked to Mike about a day of prayer. It's been on my heart. You know, this season of COVID has been hard. Let me just say that. Back in March, March 16th was my last working day at school because they were going to take 2 weeks to stop the spread. Here we are, still spreading, you know. And then April 17th, Mike was furloughed from work. We've been nurses for over 40 years. What's unemployment? We were lucky. How selfish were we? We never had to fill out papers, call people, do any of that. And I was concerned. I was worried, you know. No money coming in, and what are we going to do? You know, how are we going to take care of ourselves, our medical expenses? I'm canceling doctor's appointments. Nope, I can't come because I don't want to spend the money right now, you know. It was heavy on my heart, and one day in solitude with just me and the dog at home, I got on my knees, and I said, God, I don't know how to handle this. You got to help me. And I'm closing my eyes, and a vision of God came to me and sat with me in my chair, looked me in the eyes and said, got this. You'll be okay. And a sense of peace came over me. COVID is just one season of many struggles that people go through. During the season of COVID, we've lost income. We lost time with family and friends. We've even lost family and friends because of COVID. I have a cousin right now in Hershey Medical Center struggling to live because of COVID. But I have to give it all up to God. My 94-year-old father got COVID in October of 2020. And I'm struggling watching him by FaceTime as he struggles to breathe. Calling the hospital, what can we do, you know? But Jesus was there. God was there. He handled everything. During our time where we didn't have any income, the Lord provided. We're okay, you know. We were always givers, never takers, so it felt different to take. But that's okay. That's what God does. He gives and gives, and it's up to us to be gracious receivers. Not only that, but my father survived COVID, and he is actually now, by the grace of God, and patient in the Bath VA. And he's playing bingo. My 95-year-old father's now playing bingo. Never saw the man play a game in my life, you know, unless it was baseball in the front yard. He was a farmer, always working, always working. And if he wasn't working on the farm, he was in the church. He was in the community. He was being the leader that I should be more like. You know, he's playing bingo. He planted a garden with the Bath VA. He's out there planting a garden. The man can hardly walk, but he planted a garden. And he's singing songs. Every time I call him, he sings me a song. He's joyful for where he is, and I praise God for him. God answers our prayers. So I want you to take Wednesday or every day, but I think the more that we pray, God is a big, big God, and he can handle this big, big COVID season or whatever season you're going through. He can handle it, and we just have to surrender, which was my first word when I came here to Higher Hope. My word of the year was surrender. Do you know how hard that is to do? Well, I've learned. So I want to, first of all, thank you all for welcoming Mike and I into this church. And thank you for letting us be a part of this community. And may you all be filled with God's blessing. And I didn't say anything I read. Thank you.
So a prayer on Wednesday. Thank you, Luann. And we'll be sending some things out just to let you know some things you'll be praying about. And so be watching the email on that. You mind sharing about the concert, about what's coming up?
Yeah, certainly. Just a reminder, Saturday night is the event with Found in Favor featuring Alan Scott Band and some other speakers. Certainly hoping that you can attend. Want you really to think about, pray about bringing others that may need to come or might be struggling in something, especially in the addictive world. So please be praying about that. Come for that. I'm definitely pleading now at this point for volunteers for Saturday. We need prayer partners, as a matter of fact. The ministry wants prayer partners here for that event. We need people to help unload their equipment Saturday morning, load them back up Sunday after church, because they will be doing the worship service on Sunday as well. But, you know, ticket takers, greeters, you know, anything that really you can think of that we would need, I really could have helping hands with that. So please see me today or contact me. My email's been in the information lately. So.
All right. Just a couple other things. Thanks. We have a Wired kickoff tonight. I think this is the big one, right? This is big. So it's Truth or Dare. There'll be a lot of different scavenger hunt type things. This is for 6th to 12th grade. So if you have questions, you can see Melissa, who leads it, or you can sign up on the app or just come tonight. Is that fair to say? But it starts earlier than usual, right?
4 to 8.
It's 4 to 8. So I'd love to have anyone in 6th to 12th grade to come to that. Just a couple other things and we'll let you go. All the small groups that we have starting up, that we talk about community and how it forms, all the small groups are in that the packet that you got. So feel free to sign up this week. Those small groups will probably start in next week, after Sunday. So probably in that week or the week after, those small groups will be starting. So if you're going to be interested in one of those groups to help you grow, please sign up soon for that. There's a lot of other things happening during this month, from a serve day to some Friday night hangs. All that's in there. But we're so glad that you could worship with us. I do hope that you will cultivate your soul, even today, find some time to just allow God and work with God to do some work in your heart.